Okay. I'm here in the Anna Freud Institute of London with Professor Peter Fonagy, who is the creator of mentalization-based therapy. And I'm happy to have with him a short interview for State of Mind, the Italian web journal of psychology. The first question is about the relationship with the psychodynamic paradigm, both in more orthodox psychoanalysis or maybe drive theory, most in also, but in more flexible new directions.
It's a very good question. Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here. I'm delighted to be contributing to your very impressive journal. So thank you for giving me the opportunity. The relationship of MBT to traditional psychoanalysis is the same kind of relationship as any child has with their parent. Never want to be disrespectful. You never want to disown your origins. You always want to be very careful to make sure that you're not reacting against something out of some kind of Oedipal wish to be better than. But also you want to say that you're a little bit different, that you're not exactly the same as your parents. So both Anthony Bateman and I are psychoanalysts. We are psychoanalytically trained in the British Institute, and we both continue to be members of the British Psychoanalytic Society. And I'm very proud to be a member of the International Psychoanalytic Association, and so on and so forth. I would say that in psychoanalysis over the last probably about 60, 70 years, there has been a decoupling of a method of treatment from a theory. That is to say, the theory has continued to evolve to some degree, but the method of treatment has stayed exactly the same. Now, the reason for this is because there's so much diversity in theory that what people want to know in terms of their identity as psychoanalysts is that they're all doing the same thing. They're all on the couch, you know, three or four times a week, or, you know, being free association and transference interpretations are the central part of the intervention. My own feeling is that no therapy that was invented at the turn of the last century could still be the best form of treatment now. The fact that it kind of got frozen in time is an intellectual intellectual, but perhaps more a professional accident that shouldn't have done. It should have developed. But people who were psychoanalysts, trained as psychoanalysts, who moved away from the traditional technique were disowned by the tradition. So Aaron Beck, Altalis, a whole bunch of people who had been trained as psychoanalysts, once they started doing different things, they would say, well, you're not an analyst anymore. So they said, well, okay, I'm not an analyst anymore. I don't want to be in that position. I'm very happy to be an analyst. But I don't think that what we are doing in mentalization-based treatment is analysis. In fact, we feel that much of the traditional technique is not just, with borderline patients particularly, it's not just unhelpful, it's positively harmful, it's positively iatrogenic. And I think, you know, that obviously gets you a little bit of pushback, particularly from the classical psychoanalytic movement. Less pushback from dynamic psychotherapists, but even some pushback from dynamic psychotherapists who ask you, well, where is the unconscious then? They say, I haven't got it, it's not in my pocket, I haven't got the unconscious anyway. And unconscious is not a place. There's no doubt that people function both consciously and unconsciously, and both have thoughts that are conscious and unconscious. That in itself, to me, is part of a theory of psychology, which is very rich and which I truly believe in, which is a kind of psychoanalytic model of the contents of the mind, which I think is both influential and very helpful. So for me, it's enormously helpful to think about people feeling in conflict, that they are troubled by their emotions, that they want to feel safe, that they want to feel close to and attached to people and protected by them. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a whole range of psychological constructs that are massively helpful that psychoanalysis has brought to us. That doesn't mean that I have to practice the same way that Freud did in 1902 or whatever it was, you know, 110 years ago, when he invented psychoanalysis as it is today. So, in brief, mentalization-based treatment has many aspects of psychoanalytic theory embedded in it. It has some new aspects to it, mainly borrowed from developmental psychology and neuroscience. But as a technique, it's not psychoanalytic. It's not an insight-oriented technique. You know, the aim of mentalization-based treatment is not to give people understanding of themselves that they didn't have before. The aim of it is is limited to enhancing their capacity to think about their own behavior and the behavior of others in terms of internal states, in terms of mental states.
My impression from my cognitive viewpoint that you accept the information processing paradigm, but you want to stress also that our agency on our emotion is limited, that some cognitive omnipotence is not always possible with this. And your patient is very severe in the in the simulation I did during the training. I saw that your patients are really extremely severe.
Very ill, but they are ill, and there's a little, there's a subtlety there in what you mentioned, which is actually very interesting, because by accepting and, in fact, embracing the omnipotence of cognition, I'm also saying that when cognition as a process is malfunctioning, it is putting that individual at enormous risk. So what I'm seeing when I have somebody with the borderline spectrum of disorders is a dysfunction of the aspect of cognition that's usually referred to as metacognition or cognition about cognitions, in our word mentalizing, that a person who is not able to use their subjectivity, their awareness of their own mental states appropriately, is likely to be overwhelmed by what cognition is usually counterbalancing, which is emotion. So they present with a dysregulation of affect, which actually corresponds to a dysfunction of cognition. So rather than me, in any sense, seeing cognition as not important, I'm saying it's enormously important, because normally it would balance that affect. It would create subjectivity where cognition and affect are in more or less equilibrium. It's the absence of appropriate cognition that makes affect overly influential for these individuals. But because the cognition is dysfunctional, for me to intervene at the level of cognition is puerile. Is a complete waste of time. It's not there. It's no use me trying to change the way they construe the world, because it's that capacity that's missing. So what I have to try and do is help them bring down their emotional dysregulation sufficiently for me to be able to help them enhance their cognitive capacity and restore their balance between cognition and emotion that was missing before.
And do you think that the pretend mode is maybe a sort of fruit of this incapacity to use cognition that became something very abstract and abstract, not connected?
I think that you're absolutely right, that if an individual's capacity for representing their own mental states and the mental states of others is failing, it's not that the ambition to represent mental states disappears, but the capacity to represent it genuinely disappears. So it gets replaced by what we call kind of pretend mode or pseudo-mentalizing, which is a little bit like a wheel spinning in sand. What you recognize is that cognition is so prolific, is so abundant, that almost there is too much of it, and you feel, this is too much of a good thing, you know, this is not going to get me anywhere. You know, it's a wheel spinning, it's got no traction. It corresponds to nothing real. So one can find oneself talking to a patient in a consulting room endlessly about what they are thinking and what they're feeling, but actually doesn't lead to any progress, because there was never real cognition that you were working with. It was pretend mode. It was just something that was put in place, like a person with brain damage might confabulate a memory, but you can't remember, or you confabulate, you make something up because you feel there ought to be something there. So it's, if you wanted to call it rather a pretend mode, confabulated cognition, that would be fine by me.
Yeah. So this could be, I think, that the cognitive movement could learn from the MBT.
I'm not so keen on anybody learning from anybody else. You know, I think, you know, to me, MBT is, I don't want to establish a new school of psychology. There are enough schools out there already.
Yes.
We are talking about a particular human capacity, okay? We don't own that capacity.
Yeah.
MBT doesn't own mentalizing. You know, rational emotive therapy, transference focused psychotherapy have just as much mentalizing in it as MBT. We want to, in doing training courses in this area, we want to help people focus their clinical attention on this capacity. But I could be running training courses on attachment, or running training courses on denial, or whatever. Or for that matter, on rationality. You know, these are all very important aspects of human function. Rational emotive therapy doesn't own rationality. If you see what I'm getting, it emphasizes some aspects of it, which it's, you know, is undoubtedly very helpful in certain situations.
I have another feeling from this training that you manualized your treatment,
yeah.
You formalized it, but you don't want that concepts become too much rigid. For example, when I asked you, is this pseudo mentalization, you told me, yes, is this, but when I asked you, is pseudo mentalization connected with pretend mode?
Yeah.
You told me, yes, but not only that. Do you think that too much manualization is good, but not completely good?
Let me just be very, very clear about it.
Yes.
Let me be very clear about it.
Yeah.
I think when you are developing a measure, when you're developing something that you're going to use in scientific study,
yes,
then you must manualize.
Yes.
Okay? You must make your concepts clear and unequivocal and reliable. So, for example, we're doing a study, we have done a study, it's published now, on adolescents who had, on their way to become borderline personality disorder. Okay? So on their way, it's emergent personality disorder, okay, you'd call it. What we found was the marker, the best marker, how we recognized these adolescents, was something that we call hypermentalizing or pseudo-mentalizing. That is, they watching a piece of movie and making a narrative around that movie, saying what is going on in this movie, where are people acting, they make up stories that are more elaborate, more complicated. They have hypotheses about what's happening in people's minds that are not based on information that's in the movie. They've got an overly active mentalizing. And that's what is probably a compensation for something that's not working well enough, if you see what I mean. You know, my analogy about a wheel spinning in sand. Now, I think that is very important to define exactly, okay? But when you come to kind of more conceptual things like pretend mode, that's a developmental concept. It refers to something that children of between 2 and 3 at peak experience, but we experience it, all of us, throughout life a little bit, which is when our internal world, our experience of mental states, gets separated off from physical reality. Okay? So it's a notion that children have, that they can pretend that I am now driving a car. Okay? And as long as, as long as you don't ask me, well, is that a steering wheel that you've got in your hand, Peter? As long as you don't ask me that, I'm fine. In my mind, I can pretend that I'm. But it can't have anything to do with actual physical reality. You can't intrude into my game. And if you intrude into my game, you have to also be sure to pretend that this is a steering wheel. Okay? And we're both driving the car. That's, pretend mode is a very important construct. But something like hypermentalizing or pseudo-mentalizing is operational. Mm-hmm. We have operationalized it, we've defined it, you can score it. Something like pretend mode is a concept.
Nice.
Okay? It's an idea. And if you told me, is this pretend mode or is that pretend mode? I say, well, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. Okay, is this hypermentalizing? Yes. No. I've got a manual that tells me whether it is or it isn't. If you see what I mean.
Now I understand why yesterday you told me not to be too rigid with the pretend mode.
Yeah.
And that this should is a marker, should as a sign of low mentalization. Is a marker or a concept?
Exactly. You could make it a marker in particular context. So I'd say when somebody uses the word should, when actually there is no real reason for that definitely being said. If you said to me, you should step out of the way of that car is coming at you at some speed, I think you should move on, otherwise that car will run you over. Mm-hmm. That is not a marker of non-mentalizing. That's a marker of mentalizing. Okay?
Yes.
You're putting yourself in my position, and you're saying, look, if I was in your position, and I saw that car, I would move out of the way of that car. That car is, in terms of gravitational force, is bigger than you. And if it was an express train, that would be even more compelling. Definitely should. But if you'd use the word should in the context of something that was either based on mental states, you shouldn't be thinking that, or you should be thinking that, or you should da 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 da,
yes,
then it's very likely it's a shortcut.
Mm. Yes.
In fact, what it might well reflect is a person's uncertainty that they compensate for by being overly confident in terms of the modifiers they use. So they use should as a modifier that has the appearance of certainty about it to compensate for an absence of that certainty. That's why I would have my ears picking and saying, they use the word should. Maybe what this marks is that actually, you have no grounds for saying that. You feel that you have no grounds for saying that, and you have to be absolutely certain that you've got your message across so that you compensated for that lack of certainty.
Okay. As I told you, I was impressed by should because it's also in rational emotive therapy of Ellis. And Ellis wrote in a book that he got it from Karen Olney. So this is
interesting. As a nice psychoanalytic origin. But you know, but the mind, believe it or not, is not owned by Karen Olney,
yes,
by Albert Ellis, by Anthony Bateman, by Sigmund Freud, by Aaron Beck. The mind is ours, yours, mine, you know, and we are, none of us are in a privileged position in relation to what could, the complexities. We're all just trying to do our best.
And yes.
That's, anyway, sorry.
And what about possible future directions of
MBT.
MBT?
Well, I'm really very pleased about how MBT is going. We're very popular. Not that that means anything, you know. I mean, all kinds of people have been popular in the past. Some of them are remarkably unwholesome individuals.
Yes.
So, you know, popularity itself doesn't necessarily mean very much. Yeah. But in your country, just a recent election, Berlusconi appears to have considerable popularity without necessarily meriting some of that. But so, you know, what I'm pleased about is that it seems to be a kind of a creative movement, that people are applying some of the principles in different clinical contexts. So I'm very pleased with the family application of mentalizing. I'm extremely pleased because it makes a lot of sense to me that families, for there to function in bringing up the next generation, should have the child's mental experience in mind, and families, and support that, but also should have their own experience of the child as this new individual that's separate from them, fairly clearly represented. So the quality of mentalizing within a family, I think, is a very important marker of risk for a child. And enhancing that mentalizing, I think, is a very good, probably very broad way of intervening to protect the child in a range of contexts. So mentalizing in families is working well. We are working with kids, we are working just mentalizing, helping the developmentalizing, but in adolescence, it seems to be a crisis period for mentalizing in some ways that results in a lot of self-harm, or an increase of prevalence of self-harm that we might be able to help with by enhancing mentalizing. I think that in depression, there is a dysfunction of mentalizing in individuals construing of their own mental states, that they experience their mental states in a kind of psychic equivalence mode, and they feel bad, but rather than thinking that they are feeling bad about themselves, they mistake that for being bad, and that actually it's that collapse of mentalizing can make low self-esteem be a very toxic experience for an individual, so they feel badness, and that enhancing mentalizing can protect from that, can lighten, you know, it doesn't make a person see themselves or make them necessarily feel less bad about themselves, but the implication of that feeling changes with mentalizing. We are trying to work very hard with eating disorders, but I think there is clearly a very profound failure of mentalizing, and probably we will, I think, also succeed in mentalizing in couples therapy, particularly when the couple are struggling over in a relationship that has already broken down, but now involves children, and then there is some kind of quote-unquote competition over the child, that being able to get the couple to mentalize about their relationship, but particularly their relationship to the child, and to see things from the child perspective, can, I think, be quite helpful. So these are the kind of the different clinical contexts. some of the principles have been applied, and I think that there is creativity around it, in the sense that the principles are the same. The principles is not insight oriented, it's oriented towards enhancing mentalizing in a particular context, particularly when attachment issues are involved, particularly when emotions run high, helping an individual be more stable in their thinking about themselves and others in terms of mental states, more robust, more careful. All that, those principles in a range of clinical contexts, using quite different tools to restore mentalizing, but nevertheless using the same principles, I think is enormously helpful. And promise for me, cheers me up on a bad day when I start feeling depressed about the limitations of what I has been able to achieve.
And last question is, I remember that in Frankfurt you told us that when you're in a car with your wife, you don't mentalize.
Yeah.
Is this changed? And it depends when you drive or when it drives your wife.
It's at its worst when I drive and she navigates. And when she navigates and we go wrong, my capacity to mentalize disappears, falls to the floor. But you know, being able to recognize that and use that as something that alerts you to a potential failure of mentalizing is not the worst of strategies.
Yes.
It can help you just give you a little window, a little pause button, and think, well, maybe I'm at not my best at the moment. Maybe I should just say nothing. And that sometimes that saying nothing is the most mentalizing thing that you can do.
So thank you to Professor Fonagy and